Good morning. This is Tuesday, February 27th. I'm Norman Mark, and this is Today in Chicago. Primary day in Chicago, election day, a day when we have to trudge through snow and sleet and hail and gloom of night to vote, but when we ought to. And that'll be the topic of today's discussion with Dick Simpson, 44th Ward Alderman, on independent movement and voting patterns in Chicago. Before that, one of my favorite stories about Chicago was when they were moving the U-505 to the Museum of Science and Industry. And the U-505 was brought up to the beach at 55th Street near the Museum of Science and Industry, and some workers went out and put signs up on the outer drive because they're going to move it across the outer drive. And the sign said, quote, "Submarine crossing, drive carefully." I'd love to have a copy of those signs. When we return, Dick Simpson is going to talk about being independent in the city of Chicago. Neighborhood Government in Chicago's 44th Ward, a new book edited by my guest today, Dick Simpson, who since 1971 has been alderman of the 44th Ward. He's associate professor of political science at the University of Illinois Chicago Circle, and you're leaving as alderman. You are retiring.
In a couple of months. This election today will be an election of a successor for me, and perhaps changes in some of the other 49 seats in the city council.
Any thoughts about that? Why are you retiring? Why leave now?
Well, there are a series of reasons. When you're in the city council, you're really caught with a set of duties and a set of responsibilities which are beneficial. You can be a spokesperson, you can get public attention, you can raise issues, you can propose legislation, but you're also tied down. You can't do political organizing, you can't change the basic scope of politics in Chicago from that position. And I thought rather
you can't change the basic scope of politics in Chicago as an alderman.
No, you're tied down. You can't go out and organize and try and elect more people to the city council. You can't try and change the numbers. All you can do is perform your official duties and try and help groups around the city that are involved in the process of change. When you're out of official duty, you're actually freer to organize for change than when you're in our office.
I remember I called you a couple years ago when the people in my ward were considering
trying
to draft me as an alderman, and you painted a picture of aldermanic responsibilities that just about nearly excluded family life. I remember you said you have to have a wife who is very strong in her own right and has her own identity, or the marriage would be in trouble.
And preferably a profession or something that that is totally separate from the pressures of the political life.
Was there a personal cost to you the years as alderman?
Well, it's a terrible drain, and it takes a lot of hours. At least as I continue to teach at the university, 120-hour weeks were standard work weeks.
120-hour weeks.
You know, I never added it up precisely, but you know, you get up early in the morning and go to bed late at night, and get up the next morning and do it again. Those pressures are quite substantial, and even organizing in other areas, you don't work those kinds of weeks very often.
Now, but it's got to be a real kick to be almost the successor to Len Dupre in the city council is the one person or one of two or three who would stand up and say, "Tain't so," to a machine. It's got to be both a triumph and also a feeling that you're trying to beat your head against concrete abutments there, too.
Well, it is. It's a sort of euphoric sense occasionally when you're fighting with just a handful of colleagues in the city council over some great issue. And most of the issues in the city council do tend to be fairly momentous for such an insignificant governmental body in its general powers, because the basic struggle in the city council is whether or not we're going to have democracy and some sort of government by the people in the city, or whether we're going to have tyranny and government by the mayor and the head of the political party. And that makes all the issues much larger, and it makes some of the floor fights more fun. I don't think they will go down as the great debates in history. Usually the level of discourse is not very high in the city council.
And the parliamentary bending of rules and turning off of microphones and hooting and howling is certainly not what you would expect of a high governmental body.
It's a lot like a barroom brawl.
you get right down to it. Now, 8 years, and sometime, as you said just before the show, there's no way of knowing when your last council meeting is, because they never tell you when the council meeting is. It's scheduled almost at whim. Why is that?
The law says that we meet the second and fourth Wednesday of every month, except when we set our own date. Isn't worded quite that way, but that's the effect. And the council has always chosen to set its own meeting days, and that's for the convenience of the mayor and the convenience of the city administration. They do things when they want them passed. If they need to get some government money from the feds, we have a meeting. If they don't need money from the feds, we don't have a meeting.
Now, do you have any conclusions? 8 years, is there anything, is there any hope, for instance, for independent Democrats or even that extinct animal Republicans in this city?
Yes, but it's always a matter of question as to what will happen that really is in the hands of the voters, particularly here on primary day. Today's turnout alone, just the number of people who vote, will probably determine the outcome in the 49th ward where you live and down the 44th ward where Bruce Young is running for alderman against a machine candidate, down in the 43rd ward where Marty Overman's trying to maintain his seat. There must be five or six wards in the city where whether people go and vote or not, almost more than who they're going to vote for.
Well, now I've
will
heard
make the difference.
But
and
in
so
this,
in that sense, it's in the hands of the voters and the citizens.
Yeah, but there is a low registration right now. Very few people
since
are registering.
1930.
And I think there's a feeling that if I don't like what the administration is doing, I'm not going to vote.
Well, it is an odd time. I think there is probably more disaffection with the city administration, certainly than there were during the Daley years, when Daley was personally very popular and had a great deal of personal warmth and support, and had not encountered a problem like the blizzard, which is not all Mike Blandick's fault, but he ends up with a lot of the blame for the city not straightening it out.
It isn't his fault.
No, he didn't make the blizzard.
Oh, okay.
He didn't handle the response well. But part of it is just the gripe of the blizzard, and part of it is the distinction about what the city administration didn't do in clearing it. So the dissatisfaction with city government is probably at one of its rather high levels. On the other hand, there is no positive movement strong enough to sweep the city right this election and change the result. 20 of the elections today for aldermen, there isn't even an opponent running against the regular organization candidate.
So it's all set
they've,
up.
They've won already for 20 seats.
We're going to take a break here. When we come back, I want to talk more about independent politics and hopes for change in this town with Dick Simpson after this. Welcome back to Election Day on Today in Chicago with Dick Simpson, alderman for the 44th Ward for the last 8 years and soon to be leaving the city council. A man who in his ward created what was called neighborhood government and something called citizens' assemblies, which is part of the topic that's in your new book. What about neighborhood government? It seems to me that most people in Chicago don't believe that there is such a thing as neighborhood government, that it comes from the hall through a ward committeeman.
Well, it doesn't have to be that way, as I suppose the short answer to that. In the 44th Ward for the last 7 years, we've been experimenting with various kinds of neighborhood government. We created a ward assembly with two delegates from each precinct and one from each community organization. And that ward assembly really governed my vote in the city council and the legislation I introduced during that 7 year period. Now, they didn't consider every single one of the 3,000 votes a year I cast, but they did consider a number of the major pieces of legislation. They were the group that, for instance, designed the anti-redlining legislation that passed in 1974, which has become a model for the nation.
Yeah, but let me interrupt there, because you tried to get these assemblies in every ward, and you introduced legislation about it, and as I recall, that was one of the great hooting downs of all time. Some people rose up on their hind legs who hadn't spoken before and said, I don't need to know what the citizens of my ward are interested in.
Well, it was one of those close city council votes, about 44-4 that day. Yeah. That's right. The city hall is not going to create neighborhood government for people in Chicago. If people in Chicago want neighborhood government, they have to elect aldermen who are committed to it, and then the aldermen can carry out neighborhood government whether or not they pass the law.
All right, let's confront that.
Okay.
That would mean electing possibly government who are aldermen who are not beholden to the machine, possibly.
Mm-hmm.
And the great fear is if that happens, my garbage won't be collected, my streets won't be cleaned, the lights won't be replaced, and my police protection will go down. Aside from that, everything will remain about the same.
Well, I think the answer to that is to compare any of the independent wards with machine wards that are next door. Compare the 5th Ward on the south side to the 4th Ward or one of the other neighboring south side wards, and the 5th Ward's in better shape. Compare the 43rd and the 44th Ward on the north side to the 46th Ward or even to Tom Keene's Ward out in the 31st. The 31st Ward looks like a war zone. There are burnt out buildings, the community's a shambles, there seems to be no care taken with it at all, and that was true when Keene was alderman himself rather than when his wife was. The same in the 46th, 44th Ward, if it has one or two abandoned buildings at any time, we think it's a major emergency. 46th Ward at any time has dozens of abandoned buildings. Now there are differences in communities, and some of it can be assigned to those differences, but in terms of services in general, the level of services in independent wards and compared to machine wards next door mm-hmm. is much higher. And it doesn't mean machine aldermen can't get services. They can, but they have to work very hard at it. And independents have no choice. If they don't work hard at getting services, they won't be reelected, and they know it from the first.
Now, one of the things you talk about is a great Chicago political institution, which is the giving of coffees. I think more caffeine is poured in gullets in order to get someone elected in this town. As a matter of fact, I think most people are elected without any reference to television or radio or very many billboards, signs on telephone poles, yes. What is the function of the coffee in your election and other elections?
Well, the purpose of the coffee is to let voters in a precinct get to meet the candidate personally and to have some confidence in the kinds of answers that the candidate gives to the questions that most concern them, whether that happens to be sidewalk repair or street cleaning or dog litter or whatever the problem is. And mm-hmm. and that's important because converting some of those people in that precinct to volunteers to contact the rest of the voters in that precinct is critical. Coffees are only given by independent candidates. We have to have an army of volunteers to match the patronage army that the machine puts on the street. They don't bother with coffees very much except in response to us because they don't need it. They don't need volunteers. They won't take volunteers if a volunteer walks in off the street.
Why not?
Because they can't trust a volunteer. A volunteer works because they believe in the candidate and the issues. A precinct captain works because they believe in keeping their job at City Hall. Reliable.
But hasn't that always been so? I was reading a book about 1894 Chicago mm-hmm. politics. I was reading a book about 1930 Chicago politics.
Chicago politics has always been the same.
It always comes down to jobs.
Since
the Great Fire. Now, how can you as an independent hope to change that? How many men would you need and women in the city council in order to begin a change, effect a change?
Well, you would need in the city council about 15 aldermen to be in shooting distance of electing a mayor with 15 wards that were broken free of the pattern. In the council, first of all, you would be close enough to start playing with some of the parliamentary rules. You could block the sale of land that's public land. You could probably pick up the stray votes you need to be able to block the suspension of the rules when they have to rush something through the city council and don't have time to go through the committee process. With that power, that would be significant. And in addition, you would only need on any given vote 6 or 7 crossover votes. 6 or 7 votes are achievable. When you're only a group of 3, 4, or 5, you're too small. There's no payoff for someone who would cross over and vote with us on that kind of vote because mm-hmm. we couldn't promise them we would win. At a size of 15 or so, we would be close enough to a majority, even though a long way away. We're close enough to attract over crossovers.
Is there ever a hope of that? I mean, there's only 4 or 5 wards along the lake, which would be the most independent. Is there ever a hope of that?
Yes. My own guess is that while we had hoped originally that this 79 election would be an election in which 15 opponents to the machine of various political persuasions would be elected, that's probably not going to happen today. The registration is down. The weather has been so bad throughout the entire mm-hmm. Period of the election that the canvassers haven't been able to reach door to door. I do think that it is quite possible to increase the size of the minority bloc in the city council from 3 or 4 to something between 5 and 10.
Today.
All depending right. on what the voters do and the hours that remain.
Well, what we're going to do is break and get some news possibly about that right now. We'll be back with Dick Simpson after the news. You know, most of us aren't going to vote today. As a matter of fact, most of us won't vote later in the year when we have a chance to vote again. As a matter of fact, most of us hardly ever vote. I vote all the time because I like to pull levers and make X's in boxes. And also I like to try to tell people what I think about things. We have Dick Simpson with us today. He's the independent alderman from the 44th Ward and associate professor of political science at the University of Illinois Chicago Circle. If you could sit down with a voter, as you probably are right now, who may say, I don't need a vote. Who needs to vote? It's all the same. The same crooks are doing the same things to me anyway. What would you tell them?
Well, I think two things. First of all, many people don't realize that many elections are decided by one vote per precinct. John F. Kennedy was elected president of the United States by one vote per precinct. In fact, one vote per precinct here in Illinois.
In Chicago?
No, in the whole country.
In the whole country.
One vote per precinct. But particularly in Illinois, one vote per precinct was almost enough to be the margin in this state, which mm-hmm. was the margin for him finally. But so they think, well, what's one vote? It doesn't really matter. They're partly right. The votes are a lot of numbers, but the average ward election today for the average alderman will be decided by whoever gets 8,000 votes or 8,500 votes. That's enough to elect an alderman in a contested election. And so whether they vote or not will actually determine to some extent the outcome. In addition, I think I would say to voters that if they're really dissatisfied, and I think a lot of voters are, and that's why they're not being very active, the answer isn't to hide. The answer is to join up with other people who share their views, whatever they are, and to work on changing the electoral process over time. And that takes a steady commitment. It takes sacrifices. It takes a willingness to say, in the public arena, voters should choose. Voters should be supreme and not some group that's remote from them, that doesn't pay attention to them, that doesn't care about them. And today's a good day to have a change of view, not just about this election. Sure, vote today. Mm-hmm. Better yet, after you vote, call the headquarters of your favorite candidate and volunteer to work the rest of the day. But get the decision that you want to have control back in your neighborhood. You want to have a voice in government. You want to change things to fit your way of looking at it. That's what democracy is about. And we're very close mm-hmm. to losing democracy in this country. The government has become so remote and so unresponsive, not just in Chicago, but nationally, that I think it's a serious time, and voters have to assess if they're willing to give up a birthright, which our founding fathers did fight a revolution over. And they made sacrifices. It's our turn. We're of age. We're responsible. And we're responsible for what happens to us. It's not someone else's fault. We choose what we want for ourselves and our children.
We've really chosen all those bozos in the city council, huh?
It's our fault. If we worked, there's no election that can't be won by voters working if there are enough of them who care.
Did you have an effect when you were in the city council?
Well, I like to think so. Spent 8 years in the city council, a decade in political life in Chicago. And I think at least I may have had some influence about what the debate in Chicago is over. We didn't always win on every major piece of legislation. But I think the issue of whether citizens will have any rights and citizens any voice and control over the city is an issue that will continue to be debated after I've left the city council.
I think if there's any conclusion to this morning, it's a hope or a prayer that people will get up, get out of bed, fight whatever snow is out there and rain and mush or whatever, and vote whichever, Bolandic, Byrne, Wallace, Johnson, whichever, but vote. Today to exercise your birthright, I suppose.
That's right.
Okay. Dick Simpson, thank you, and congratulations on 8 years. I hope you believe they're well spent. I thought they were anyway. Dick Simpson, the author of this book, Neighborhood Government in Chicago's 44th Ward, just out. Tomorrow, we're going to be talking about local television and network television with Ginny Weissman of the Tribune. Have a good day. Vote. Stay tuned for the Today Show.